Just ask you to join me in a word of prayer, please. Almighty and everlasting God. God, together we, your people, gather here in this holy place. We acknowledge, dear God, that we are entering into your presence undeservedly. You've not done anything that would qualify us or would earn for us this privilege. But dear God, because of who you are, because of your love, your grace, your endless mercy, dear God, you've made room for us. You created a space that we could come and enter into your presence, that we could humble ourselves before you, that we could present ourselves to you, O God. So, Lord, we come acknowledging that you are God and we are not. That you are fully in charge.
Yes, Lord.
We surrender to you.
Thank you, God.
We pray, God, that you would make sense of this thing we call life.
Yes.
Help us to discover how we are to serve you and to live for you. Dear God, we pray that you would redefine for us joy and happiness and peace. That it would come to be to us what it means to you. And that we would follow after you fully.
Yes, God.
We give your name praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory. It's in the matchless eternal name of him who is yet alive, Jesus, who is the Christ, we pray. Amen. Praise God, give an honor to you, Almighty God, who is indeed God.
All God,
yes, from everlasting unto everlasting, he remains God. And we give him honor in this place. Give honor to my angel, our long, my bride, Reverend Vivian Elwright. I thank God for her and who she is. Amen. That's right. For these preachers who do a fantastic job of serving God, being faithful and true, committed to kingdom building. I thank God for them. And for each and every one of you who made it to this place, I thank God that you're here. I praise God for your presence. You didn't have to be. You could have chosen other places. You could have done something else with your valuable time, but here you are. Right here, so that we can worship and glorify God together. And so I just want to say I appreciate it, I thank you, and I acknowledge your contribution and sacrifice. For we serve a God who is worthy of our sacrifice, but we can never give him enough. But give him all that we have is what he requires, and he deems that appropriate. So we thank God for him and for you and for all who's gathered in this place. But as always, I'm going to invite you and encourage you to come over and see Jesus with me. Because I still believe everything in me, we can see it, we can make it. It's hard and it's ugly, and sometimes this world just don't make a whole lot of sense. You hit places that you want to give up, and other places where you just wonder why this time has to end. And this stuff has a roller coaster ride up and down and through dark tunnels, and you just don't know if you should be happy, excited, or sad and scared. You just don't really understand what this life is doing, and we don't always know. But there is a God who is a way-making God.
Hallelujah.
If we will just follow him, he'll get us through. He'll get us through.
Yes, he will. Yes,
he will make a way for us. He'll do it. So if you have your Bibles, come with me to the Gospel according to Luke. Luke chapter 23. Go to verse 46. Now, I know it's the Christmas season, and some folk will say the pastor got his seasons mixed up, his holidays confused, because this is normally a Easter or a Good Friday even text. It's one of the seven last words. I'm not confused. I know it's Christmas time. I know, but you know, the whole Bible is good for the whole life. Amen. So it's okay. It's okay to read an Easter text in Christmas season. Luke chapter 23, verse 46. It reads, Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last. Just for Say it together, if you will, with us. We are to live as Jesus died. We're to live like he died. This is Christmas about birth. It's about life. And yes, our life should be modeled after God. That we ought to find ourselves living to give him glory. But many times we get in situations where life just don't seem to work. It doesn't seem to work out the way it should. And we say things like, I've done my best. I did my best. I've tried my best. I don't know why it ended up this way, or it's just not in me. I'm not there yet. And we kind of reduce living for God to a sense of doing, because we make it about what we do and or what we don't do. And we figure if we do a certain amount, God ought to reward us with a good life. And we don't understand why he doesn't answer our prayer. We went through the trouble to pray. And we don't understand why God don't do what he's supposed to do when we do what we're supposed to do. You know, we hold up our end of the bargain. We don't always get it. Why it don't work right? Why it's not moving in the right direction? We don't always get it and understand how it's functioning or not functioning. We just don't always understand. It don't seem to come together like it should. But I want us to come to the place where we can recognize that life is not about doing, it's really about being. If you look at what God has always done, God has always given us, shown us his love in a way to how we ought to be. And he's shown us, because what the enemy does is the enemy tries to so fill our hearts and our minds full of stuff that we turn and start moving away from God, you see? Because as long as my heart is on God and my mind's on God, I'm going to do God's stuff. But when the enemy starts taking my mind and my heart and filling it with a whole bunch of other stuff, pride, pain, suffering, joy, peace, money, whatever it is, he fills my mind and my heart with stuff, then I'm going to start doing whatever my heart and mind is filled with. So if I'm filled with pleasure, I'm going to chase after pleasure. If my heart, my mind is filled with money, I'm chasing after money. If it's a peace and my heart, mind is just committed to peace, I gotta have peace. And I'm going to create what I call peace, and I'm gonna go after that, because my heart, my mind is what leads me, because that's who I be at that moment. Who I be is determines what I do with my life. So we ask, why doesn't it work? No, I do all the right things. Well, you may do the things that you call right, but the real question, Clifford Wright Sr., is, are you being the right person? See, I may do the right stuff, but I may not be the right man. I may do the right stuff, but I may not be the right Christian. And what we find is that we always want God to see a miracle. I'm on my way to this text. We always want God to send us a miracle to bail us out of stuff we done got ourselves in. God, I didn't do the right thing. I'm sorry, will you send a miracle? God, I said the wrong thing. I'm sorry, but will you send a miracle? God, I didn't take care of myself like I was supposed to. And now, will you send a miracle? God, I abused the relationship, but will you send a miracle? We want God to send us a miracle. And God is a miracle working God. And we say stuff like, the best is yet to come. He's never leave us like this. He's going to make a way out of nowhere. We say stuff that make us feel good and it convinces us that God got a miracle on the way. But the truth of the matter is, everywhere through your Bible, you'll find that there is human participation with every miracle. There's a human element of every miracle. And when the Red Sea was parted, the children of Israel had to go through. Before Goliath fell, David had to throw the stone. Before the lion refused to eat, Daniel had to go into the den. There's always a human element. So there's something that we have to do, something we have to be if we want God's miracle to give us the right consequence or the right results that we're looking for. And how does that happen? Thanks for asking. It is when we look at how Christ died. You see, the passion of Christ is the microcosm of the gospel. If you look at the passion of Jesus, it's in his passion that the whole gospel story is told.
Yeah.
If you can't read any part of the Bible except the passion, you got enough to serve God with the rest of your life. Because how he went to the cross, how he did, and who he was hanging on that cross, help us understand how I ought to live my life. I may not always understand what I got to do. I may not understand what the next right thing is to do. I may not always know what God wants next, but I can know what kind of attitude I'm supposed to have. I can know what kind of character I'm supposed to be of. I can know what kind of spirit should be living in me. I may not know the next thing, but I know the right me to be. I may not understand who I should put my confidence in other than God, but I do know that I should have the confidence to put my faith in the God who's able. There's the way to do that. How? Well, look at Christ on the cross. When or Christ dying, how he's approaching the cross. One of the things that I want to point out to us, that he went to the cross loving and forgiving. Okay. He didn't go to the cross like us. He was on his journey to give his life like we ought to live. He was loving and forgiving. Here he was, knowing that he was going to be betrayed, knowing that they were going to run off and leave him, knowing that they were going to turn their back on him, knowing that they were going to deny him. He knew they were going to betray him, and yet he tied a towel around his waist and bent down and washed their feet and served them at the table. Can I serve folks who know I know don't mean me no good? Can I serve folks? I know they're coming after me, but I still will serve them and love them. He went to the cross knowing you're not going to be with me. You're going to forsake me. You're going to leave me by myself. But I'm still going to serve you. I'm still going to love you. He has that ability to love and to forgive. Maybe that's how we ought to live. With the ability to love and forgive. Knowing that they're going to leave and knowing that they're going to forsake. He had that tenacity, that ability. But not only that, he showed us on the cross that he was concerned about family. He was concerned about for social order and the well-being of people. There he was. Can't you see him hanging on the cross? And he says, look, man, there's your mother. Woman, there's your son. In other words, y'all take care of one another. Yeah. Look out for one another. I ain't going to be here. What if we live not always looking out for ourselves, but making sure that other relationships are put together? What if it wasn't all about me, but it was about doing God's work? What if I live concerned with making sure that other folk ate, other folk heard about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, other folk knew what it was to be loved, other folk knew what it was to be warm in a cold winter's night? What if that was my passion?
Amen.
What if I lived that way?
Amen.
Look at Ryan. What if I lived? What if you lived the way Jesus died? Concerned about other people and what they're going through, because he loves and he forgives. And what about when he forgave the folk? When he said, right there, even there he was. Y'all remember? He was there on the cross and he looked down and he said, Father, forgive them. For they know not what they do. And he said to the thief, today, you're going to be with me in paradise. What if I was concerned so much about folk salvation and their eternal state that I can interrupt the course of my life?
Oh, yeah. Come on.
To forgive them for what they've done to me.
Yes.
Then it's not so much about me that it was Jesus was saying, Father, they put thorns in my head. Father, they just beat me all about my back. Father, they nailed me to this cross. Because I want to ask you a question. I want to ask you a question. Why didn't Jesus pray for the Jewish council? He prayed for the Roman soldiers, Father, forgive them. But he didn't pray for the Sanhedrin. He didn't say, Father, forgive them. Why didn't he pray for the thief that didn't repent? He was like that. He could say, Father, forgive him.
Well,
but he didn't. He only prayed for the soldiers. How come? Why? Everybody else was in trouble. Everybody else was headed for a devil's hell.
All right.
Why did he only pray for the soldier? Why not the rest of the sinful folk? Because, y'all hear me clearly? Because of the phrase, for they know not what they do. You see, the other folk knew what they were doing. The Jewish crowd, they knew what they were doing. The other thief heard the testimony of the repentant thief. He knew what he was doing. But the soldiers thought, I'm just doing my job. I'm just doing what I got to do. See, you keep running around here asking God to forgive us for stuff. We know it's wrong. We know it's messed up. We know we ain't supposed to be doing it. Jesus said, forgive them, for they know not. He can't say that about me. But he know not.
Well,
because I know.
Yes.
What is it that he can't pray for you?
Whoa.
Why can't he can't say, Father, forgive them for? Oh, Father, forgive them for. Because you know what you do.
Yes.
You know how to live it. What the alternative is.
Yes.
I know how to please him. I know how to live holy. I know how to stop it. I know how to put an end to it. I know how to get out of it. I know how to put it away. I know what to do with it. I know.
Jesus.
So why, if Jesus won't pray for my forgiveness, because I won't give up the lifestyle, I wonder what good it do for me. To keep asking God to forgive me what I am about to give up.
Wow.
I just wonder. I wonder. If I ain't got no mind to give it up, I just don't want to be held accountable. I said, God, forgive me on Tuesday, but I'm going to do it Tuesday night. I just wonder if it do any good. I just wonder. I don't know. I just wanted to.
Yeah. Well, oh, God.
But he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not.
Oh, my God.
But the rest of the folk,
Jesus.
They didn't have the benefit of the prayer.
Okay.
But maybe they knew. But that's a sideline. That's what the preacher said. Yeah. But look, what if we lived? What if we lived? What if we lived like he died? Sacrificially.
Yes.
Willingly giving ourselves for the good of others. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians that he became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So he willfully gave himself, became the slain Lamb of God, the sacrificial Lamb of God, willingly giving himself for the good of others. Now understand, he didn't give himself for others. He gave himself for the good of others. See, then there's a difference in letting folk abuse you because you're afraid to stand up. Or letting them abuse you because you won't get out of her. Or is a difference in giving yourself over to them because it's something in it for you. There's a difference in that. And doing what giving yourself for the good. In other words, when you give yourself for the good, you're giving yourself so the will of God can take place in their lives. I give myself for the will of God to take place in you. I will bear the burden of your life so the will of God can take place in you. But if you're not allowing the will of God to take place in you, then I'm not giving my life for your nonsense.
Hey, come on. Come on.
He gave his life for the good. And the Bible says, Paul wrote that he gave himself. He took, he became sin for us. He took on our sin so that we might become the righteousness. He didn't just take our sin to take our sin. He took our sin so that we might become the righteousness. So what if we live that way? No. I'm willing to help you, but only when you're willing to walk, fall after God. I'm willing to give you a bigger burden, but when you get ready to follow the Lord, we lived. Not where we lived. How people may tithe us. We're more concerned with how God views us. Why we live that way? I just wonder. What happened? Jesus did it sacrificially. Be the Lamb of God. He gave himself for us. And even to the point, as he committed to the Father, he allowed himself to feel the sin of the world so much so that it somehow distorted his relationship because he declared, Father, my God, why have you? Now understand, look at this. We talked last week about Abraham and Isaac and how they looked behind, Abraham looked behind himself and saw a ram in the bush. Sometimes when we live like Jesus died, there is no ram. Jesus was on the cross and there was no ram. There was no ram in the bush. There was nowhere to turn and get another sacrifice. Yeah. Sometimes when we follow after God, there's no one to sacrifice in our place. There's no one to carry our burden. There's no one that we can offer up to take the weight of our life. There's no one that we can blame. There's no one. There's no ram. What if we lived our lives with the understanding that here I am, God, and there's no ram for me.
Oh my God.
I know Jesus died. I know some of you theologians say, but Jesus is our ram. Yes. But we're modeling our lives after him. So what if I say, Lord, there's no ram. This thing has befallen me. This thing has stopped here at my door. This responsibility is here. I got to deal with this. I can't assign it to nobody else. I can't give it away.
Come on.
I can't let nobody else. I got to go through this. I got to deal with this. I got to bear this. I got to lift this thing up to your glory, to your honor, to your praise. Yeah. I got to go. Well, how many things will we not let go?
Yeah.
How many things will we not give away? Pain when we save other people and we say, God, it's me and there's no ram.
Oh God.
I'm accountable.
Yes. Oh my God.
I gotta do it. Why do we live that way? I just wonder. There's no ram. Maybe we'll stop asking the question, why me? How come me? Why is this in my life? It's in your life because there's no ram. There's nobody for you to pass it off to. I know we're in this thing together. And there's folks who are going to come along and help. There's people gave him a drink on the cross.
Yeah.
But could nobody give him the cross in his place? We have to be here. Because if we do, what's going to keep us up here? What's going to keep us with the no ram? There's no ram. What's going to keep us on the cross? There's no ram. What's going to, it's being committed. And without compromise, proud of who we are. See, a lot of the problems with me and in the church today is sometimes I'm made to feel uncomfortable about being Christian.
Okay.
See, sometimes with me, I'm made to feel like something's wrong with me mentally if I'm a Christian. That I'm in denial if I'm a Christian. That being a Christian is synonymous with being hypocritical. That you hate everybody else, but you preach love. You reject everybody else, but you say you got the only way. And so it don't make a whole lot of sense. It don't, even for you black Christians, it really don't make sense. You went through civil rights talking about being Christian, how the Lord set you free, and now you want to close out homosexuals and all. They're going through the same thing you went through. How come you be
Okay.
I'm a living testimony.
Okay.
And we don't allow our conversation, our voice to declare that God is God. And, but look at Jesus. Jesus was dragged first into the home of the high priest. And he knew what they were looking for, an excuse to crucify him.
Yeah.
And what did he do? Committed. He said, are you the Christ? He says, I am the King of the Jews. Yeah. I am. So wait a minute. Jesus, all you had to do was continue to keep your mouth shut.
Okay.
Why, Jesus, did you admit that you were the King of the Jews? Why did you admit that you was the Son of God? You knew you was the Son of God. They couldn't stop you from being the Son of God. Just don't say you're the Son of God.
Well,
just don't say it.
Don't say
it. And don't change who you are. Live like the Son of God among them.
Okay.
But Jesus wasn't ashamed, and he didn't compromise, and he said, I am. They decided it's time for him to die. They mistreated him. They took him to Pilate. And Pilate said, are you the King of the Jews? And again, Jesus ain't got no better sense than say, I am. What about us? What about us on our jobs, in the marketplace? What about us in our home? What about us? Do we have the courage to hope challenge us and why we don't do certain things, why we believe certain things? Are we bold enough to say, but I am a child of the Most High God. I am a redeemed one. I am a child of Abraham. I'm a Christian.
Yeah.
Do we have the ability to do that?
Yeah.
What if we lived like he died? Jesus. I'm going to admit it. But he endured so much.
Yes, Lord.
He endured so much. They marginalized him his entire life. He was denied by one of his closest friends. He was betrayed by his disciple. He was beaten in Jerusalem, the courts of the high priest, and he was beaten by Roman soldiers. He was beaten. He was crucified on the cross, and that wasn't bad enough. They mocked him while he was going through the crucifixion after having beat him. He endured so much. Why would you endure so much? Does he really want us to go through all that? He paid for my sins so I can have joy, didn't he?
Come on.
He wants me to be happy, don't he? Why, Jesus, did you do that? How come? I know, I heard you, because he loves us. That's true, but that's not why he did it. He did it because it was his Father's will.
Yes.
You see, in the garden the night before, Jesus prayed. And he says, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. You see, when you make up your mind before the pain comes that you're going to trust God all the way through the pain, it's an easier proposition. But if you wait till the pain comes to try to decide what God's will is and what your move is, it's a 50-50 toss-up. But God, Jesus is on his way. They're going to come and take me. They're going to crucify me. It's going to hurt. I don't want to do it. But Father, right now, let's work this thing out. It's not my will, but your will. See, when you know stuff is coming, you know it's going to happen. Life is going to happen. God, they tried to misuse me on my job. God, my health is going to get bad as I get older. God, my children, I don't know how they're going to turn out. But God, it's not my will. It is your will. Let your will be done. When the shoe falls, it's easier. I ain't say it was easy. I said it's easier. I didn't say you won't cry. I just said it's easier because you've already made up your God, your way.
Yes.
What if we live that way?
Yes, yes, Lord.
What if we live like Jesus?
Yes. Hallelujah.
What if we live?
Yes. Hallelujah.
Like he died.
Yeah.
See, you ain't got to know what to do. You just got to be sure that you're the right person doing it. Not the right one to do it. The right one doing it.
Yes.
So you got to make sure that your heart is right with God as you're doing what comes, because that's where the joy is. You see, there is victory in the camp. Jesus went through what he went through, not because he's going to take an L. Jesus went through what he went through, not because he felt he was going to lose. He didn't go through all that because he thought he was going to be defeated. He went through that because he knew that victory is on the other side of obedience. Victory is on the other side of obedience. Victory is on the other side of obedience. I can't get to victory without going through obedience. I can't take no shortcut, no roundabout, no fly over or dig under. I can't get to victory unless I go through obedience. I got to obey him to get to the victory he has for me. I cannot know the fullness of God's joy, the weight of God's peace, the power of God's love if I don't obey him. Amen. Obedience leads to victory.
Yes.
You got to go through it.
Yes.
To get to victory. And Jesus understood that. Jesus had went through what he went through because he knew that he's going to be a world beater. See, he's going to be an overcomer. And he says, because I've overcome, don't you threat. Don't be afraid. You can overcome too, because I've already overcome.
Yeah.
You see, he's already made the way. He's the early dispatch team that went out to get the road ready, to get the situation right. He went out and mapped out the course. He's the worker for AAA that plot all the rest stations and which way to turn and what road to close. He's the satellite of your GPS. He knows which way to go. He's already gone out.
Yeah.
He said, look, I've already overcome the world. Now you can too.
Yeah.
Just follow me, obey me, turn here, go there, go on. Come on straight. I already prepared this way for you.
Yeah.
He's done it so that we can make it. But we mess up and we fall and we get lost and we hurt ourselves because we won't do it his way.
That's right.
See, I did my best, but that's not his way.
Oh.
I tried it, but that's not his way.
Oh, God.
So because when does the try become stop being prerequisite?
Mm-hmm.
You see, we try until we get tired.
Mm-hmm.
But we follow until it's over.
Oh.
Can't just try.
Yeah.
My mom used to say, don't be the failure but a try, but a try is a good excuse to fail.
Mm.
You hear me? Don't not be a failure but a try is a good excuse to fail.
Mm.
Because when you say I'm going to try it, you're not saying I'm going to do it. You're just going to say I'm going to put some effort behind it. And if it works out, if it become advantageous for me to continue, then I'm going to continue.
Okay.
But if I decide I'm going to quit, then I'm going to quit. See, that's a try. And then I can't say what's wrong with you. You just said, I didn't say I was going to do it. I just said I was going to try. I tried it and it didn't work. See, a try is just a good excuse to fail. But when we fall after God, we say, God, I'm going to do it. I'm going to find you. I'm going to go. Why? Because he's an overcomer. He's an overcomer. He's an overcomer. He said, wait a minute. This is victory. But last point. Question for you. The question is this: what is the victory?
Yeah. Well,
what is it? See, for most of us, the victory is I prayed for the car and got it. The victory is I pray that God would take the taste out of my mouth and I don't do it no more.
Okay.
I pray that God would deliver me from that relationship that he did.
Mm-hmm.
See, for most of us, the victory is the end result that we desire,
okay. Or
the absence of the sin that we think we want to get rid of right now. So we say, God give us the victory because he overcome the sin. God defeated sin. God canceled sin. But that's not the victory.
Ah. Mm.
That's just the result of warfare.
Okay.
And God don't always fight war like we. God don't always fight wars like we expect him to. You remember when they came to get him in the garden, right?
Okay.
And then they came out with sticks and clubs and knives. They came out to kill or do war. And when his boy Peter popped his switchblade and cut off the soldier's ear, Jesus says, no, you're fighting the wrong way. And Jesus did something that you never do in war. He healed the enemy. The one who came to kill him, he healed. The one who came to destroy him, he healed. So sometimes we get mad at Jesus because Jesus don't fight like we want him to. We want Jesus to kill our enemy, Jesus heal it. We want Jesus to destroy our enemy, Jesus saves it. Jesus, you ain't fighting right. I got a knife and I'm ready to cut, and That's how we do sometimes. You don't always fight. But see, the victory ain't destroying the enemy.
Okay.
The victory ain't sending the devil to the pit of hell. The victory ain't just you overcoming the Satan's in your life. The victory is not just you moving up in the world, earning more money, healing your body, and fighting the right way. That ain't the victory.
Amen.
Come on.
What's the victory? It's in the text. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. You see, the victory is that when Jesus was starting his ministry, the Father said, "This is my Son, and whom I'm well pleased." And now at the end of his ministry, God is still so pleased that Jesus said, "I'm coming home. I don't need you to judge me. I don't need you to tell me if I'm right. I don't need to tell them I still please you, but I'm coming home because I know that my life has pleased you." The victory is to live your life in such a way that you know God is pleased with you. To live in such a way that when he comes, he's like, "Father, I'm coming home. I know you're pleased. You're pleased with how I live. You're pleased with how I talk. You're pleased with what I do. You're pleased." It's not the absence of sin. It's the presence of God's pleasure in you. That's victory. God pleased you. And the victory showed up. And the enemies are now not even a thought. Your conversation with God put the enemy in his place. You ain't got to spend all your time fighting something, trying to be delivered from something, trying to overcome something, trying to get away from something. Every time you look around, you pay more attention to what you're running from than who you're running to. You're trying to get over this, away from that, buy that, more of this, because that's what you're always trying to do. But when you get that thing right and you start focusing on God, your conversation with God, your life with God, the enemy, you ain't hardly think about him, and he'll be put in his place. How do you know? Because nobody controls death enough to command their spirit to leave. Jesus says, "Father, I'm coming to you because I believe you're pleased with me. And I'm coming now."
I'm coming right now.
Death didn't have a thing to say with it. He didn't have a thing to say about it. Death couldn't say, "Wait a minute," or wait, "Girl, you should have been five years ago." The only thing death could do is sit there and watch Jesus says, "All right, come on. It's your turn." That's all that he can do is watch Jesus control him.
Okay.
And when you start living for God, all those things that you call problems, all they can do is watch you control them. Watch how you use the favor of God to control the pain in your life, the suffering in your life, the disappointment in your life. "God, I'm coming home. Watch what I do with you. Watch how I don't think about you. Watch how you have no power in my life. Watch how I get over you. You thought you had this. Watch." But that's not the victory. The victory is, "God, I'm coming. I belong to you. And I ain't talking about dying to get there. I'm talking about a spirit that you say, 'God, my spirit belongs to you. My life belongs to you. My soul belongs to you. I live like Jesus died.' Therefore, pain, you have no real impact. Devil, you've been marginalized. Suffering, you have no place." Don't mean it ain't gonna happen. Death came. Death claimed our Lord. But it came at his beckoning. And it left when he sent it away. Come on. Hold me for 3 days. It is 3 days. All right, Jeff, you done your job. Go on now. I'm up.
Yes, sir.
You see, that's what it is when you live like he died. You ain't got to be so beat up that you're always looking for a fight.
Yeah.
You ain't got to be living so broken that you're always looking for somebody to heal you and make you better. If you do it the way God wants you to do, you can live unto God. Holy, no man won't come. And just not, that's when scripture's like, "No weapon formed against me shall prosper." That's when that means something. But if you're living outside of God's will, that weapon that formed will prosper, and it's going to hurt you.
Okay, Pastor.
Yes, sir.
It's going to break you. But when you're living for God, that weapon may form, but it will not prosper. Why? Because God raises up a standard against it.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm just trying to say to us.
Woo! That's some good stuff right there.
As the enemy is trying to break the backs of the church and cut major arteries.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Well,
We who are willing to serve God.
Yes.
It's time to stop.
Yes. My Lord, my Lord.
It's time to stop living
Hallelujah.
Like Peter.
Yeah.
If you can't cut, you run.
Oh, God. Mm. Oh,
yeah.
And we got to start living, serving God.
Glory.
Yes. In a way to give him honor.
Yeah.
Now, I know some of y'all say, I ain't there yet. Mm. But see, it's that attitude. You'll never get there.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. No, the Lord's not going to open you up and add you, add the will to you like you add sugar to your coffee.
Wow.
He's not going to do that. You have to be willing to say, God, here I am.
Yes.
Oh my God. On the altar of my heart, I sacrifice me to you.
Yes.
All of me belong to you.
Yes.
I want to live. Died for me. What if we did that? Collectively, the world will be turned upside down by us. Individually, we would know what true victory in Christ look like, feel like, taste like.
Yes.
What if we did it? The question I pose to you is, why don't we? And more personally, let's live like he died.
Yes, yes.
Right attitude.
Yes.
Right spirit.
Bless you,
committed to a God who will never leave nor forsake.